टेक दिस कैमरा फोकस दिस टेक ओके सो इन आवर फाइनल डिस्कशन इन दिस नॉवेल वन नाइट एट द कॉल सेंटर एज वी हैव सीन अर्लियर ऑल्सो दैट द नॉवेल वन नाइट एट द कॉल सेंटर इज एज सच नॉट कंसिडर्ड एज अ ग्रेट नॉवेल अ ग्रेट नॉवेल बट वेरी मच अ पार्ट ऑफ पॉपुलर लिटरेचर And in that context, we deliberately use this word that what is popular is not in that sense literature, into inverted commas, or what we consider as, for example, highbrow literature. So those who want to speak in favor of popular literature, they will use the word highbrow literature. So that also becomes derogatory for what is known as proper literature. Or sometimes people use just inverted commas, inverted comma, to define literature. So you want to say that, well, this literature idea does not include popular literature. Popular literature also is known as genre fiction, pulp fiction, and other things that also we will see. So here we consider One Night at the Call Center as that popular literature, which in a way is considered as derogatory or not up to the mark of what we call it high literature. So in that context, we try to see. So we have used this novel to study many other aspects of literature, like what is self-help genre that we have tried to see earlier, how globalization can impact literature. So how those aspects of globalization changes our economies, our social structures, and it forces us to detraditionalize. So when we try to be global, one of the forces is about we have to leave our traditions and we have to assimilate with global traditions. So that detraditionalization, that also how it happens. And along with that, there is resistance to detraditionalism. There is resistance to globalization economically, culturally, socially. And so what comes is lots of narratives about one's own culture, one's own religion, and one's own nation. And nationalism becomes very important part to see how globalization is counter-argued in various narratives. So this novel helps us understand all these aspects also, all these facets of globalization, self-help, cyberpunk, science fiction, new genre in science fiction about cyber things. So that all opportunities we are getting. And along with that, we also see what is popular literature and how we can compare the things there. So we still keep in mind that anything that is popular doesn't mean it doesn't have a value. If something is popular, it doesn't mean it is valueless. So if anything becomes popular with the masses, we can't say that, well, it is popular, so it is inferior. And so people love to watch it. That is a very sweeping generalization which cannot be accepted. And when you say that if you don't accept, then what are your examples? So people give examples of William Shakespeare to Wordsworth, a range of such writers. Even Charles Dickens become a part of those things. Or even Adiga's White Tiger also was quite popular also. It was also not as popular as Chetan Bhagat, but still significantly a good selling happened with those texts also. Ian Martel's Life of Pi also became popular, and cinema also became very popular also. So, but still Ian Martel or Adiga, we don't know whether how they will be recorded in the history of world literature. But we know the examples of Wordsworth or William Shakespeare, who are considered as one of the greatest dramatists and poet who changed the way the histories are written. So you have a new phase of romanticism with lyrical ballads, and 1798 significantly marks the beginning of a new era. So, but he was very popular, and as we have discussed, he was criticized also, considered as the one who is writing nursery rhymes. And people say nursery rhymes are not poetry, simplicity and other kinds of things. So, but still very popular, yet considered as classic, or who has written great literature. William Shakespeare and Ben Jonson. William Shakespeare stands much ahead of Ben Jonson, wherein Ben Jonson was much ahead of his time in this kind of debates there. Today we put Chetan Bhagat in the same way as a kind of an inferior writer in that sense, not like writing something really great, but he is writing something that is very popular among the masses. So that distinction also, again, we debate that Chetan Bhagat kind of writers are very popular, but they are not writing great literature. So popular doesn't mean it is not great, but here we have a popular which is not great. That is where we are making it clear. So we do not put right now in this discussion Chetan Bhagat with either Wordsworth or William Shakespeare or any other popular writer, even not with J.K. Rowling also. J.K. Rowling also was very popular with cinema and books and everything also. But still with J.K. Rowling also, we do not put Chetan Bhagat. We put it him as the popular means inferior literature. In that category, we try to put and try to study this. So popular fiction is also known as genre fiction. So a kind of a popular genre where people write to encash that particular genre, where there are crime thrillers are there. Crime thrillers, murder mysteries, those things are considered as genre fiction. Detective fictions, they are very popular. But see, you always find that, well, you can't say Sherlock Holmes is only popular. Or Agatha Christie is not only popular, but they are now classic also. They are classic also. But it doesn't mean Chetan Bhagat wrote last three novels, which is about murder mysteries. But then still, you can't put Chetan Bhagat with Agatha Christie. Or even Arthur Conan Doyle, you can still put him with the murder mystery also. Dan Brown is writing a murder mystery, again a very popular writer, but people read something else also among all these popular writers also. So genre fiction or pulp fiction is also known as pulp. Pulp means inferior quality, it's a noun for the paper quality. So the paper quality is very inferior, and loko emne sastu sahitya pan ke, sastu sahitya. એટલે સસ્તા મટીરિયલનું કાગળ સસ્તું અને કન્ટેન્ટ પણ સસ્તું. ધ કન્ટેન્ટ ઓલ્સો ઇઝ હવે સસ્તું સાહિત્ય આવે, પેકેજિંગ બહુ સારું થઈને આવે છે. નાઉ વી હેવ બ્યુટિફુલ પેકેજિંગ ઓફ સસ્તું સાહિત્ય. સો અર્લિયર ઇટ વોઝ ધીસ પલ્પ ફિક્શન. વાય એ ઇઝ એડલ્ટ, યંગ એડલ્ટ ફિક્શન. યંગ એડલ્ટ ફિક્શન ઇટ ઇઝ ઓલ્સો અ જોનર, યંગ એડલ્ટ. સો Chetan Bhagat also writes for those people who are looking for marriage and jobs. So it is that young adult, or Harry Potter also is young adult, transition from that to that kind of thing we can see. Or also like this adult, prime concern for the adult is seen as love and marriage. Love, breakup, dating and marriage. So this novel is full of those dating episodes, which we have totally skipped in our discussion. We have not seen the part of the dates and lots of things that is written in the narrative. So love, breakup, dating kind of a thing that keeps on happening. So like dating becomes so common nowadays. Like novels are written about date becomes a symbol and other thing. But earlier date was only khajur. Earlier when people talk about date, ek to tarikh hoy atha khajur hoy. Baki biju triju ema kai na aave. Now dating has become completely different kind of a thing there. So that all plays a vital role in understanding this young adult. There is a very interesting genre known as Mills and Boon. Mills and Boon, if you see, which was very popular. Yes, Mills and Boon books. Let me share the screen for the online students. Okay, yeah, so. So you will see Mills and Boon books, if you will find, and they are very popular books and lots of series of those. And again, the theme is love, breakup, marriage, dating and that kind of thing, and those kinds of relations up till there that the people keep on talking about. So Mills and Boons, if you will find, that Mills and Boon is a company, and this company is something which tries to publish the books. They may hire the writers, various. They hire the writers, and then they publish. 1908, the beginning of 20th century, and very popular write-ups that they have done in this context. So that also becomes part of this. And Sidney Sheldon is known as a great popular writer. Sidney Sheldon. Who keeps on selling lots of such kind of works there. young adult fiction, and dramedy is also the word that is given to such kind of fiction, or even Chetan Bhagat's novel, which is the word which is more appropriate for soap operas. The word which is more appropriate for soap opera. And the word now which is used for television series. For TV series, the word. Earlier, operas were sponsored by soap making companies. Soap making companies even today sponsor lots of these TV programs, which are normally meant for the women. Normally, this program which are meant for women. And so that is where the advertisement of soaps become very important. Detergents, detergent powder, washing machines, washing powders, all those things are. So the series which started in the afternoon time, those repeat telecast of what used to come at 9 o'clock, 8 o'clock, that time, and that soap opera series kind of thing. They can be known as dramedy. One of the important characteristics of dramedy, obviously, it is a portmanteau. Portmanteau means mixture of two words, drama and comedy. But drama means Rona Dhona. But at the end of Rona Dhona, everything is okay. At the end of Rona Dhona, everything ultimately is okay for. But in between, there is Rona Dhona. So drama and comedy, dramedy, a kind of a thing. Which normally is ruling most of the countries. Television program, television space is occupied by those kinds of things. One important characteristics of dramedy is that they do not challenge the audience too much. They do not challenge to think, or they do not even emotionally also harass them a lot. Disturb. They do not disturb the audience. Audience may be in their cocoon. Having a cocoon in their cocoon, so those cocoons are not broken. If you break a cocoon, then people have to go out of the box, and people don't want to go out of their comfort zones. So they just try to pamper the audience within their comfort zones, and intellectually or emotionally, something that is discomfortable is not served to the audience. That is a dramedy. That is how dramedy can be seen in that context. So from this, what emerges when we look at this, from this idea emerges that this literature, highbrow or popular literature, when we try to see what it is not, helps us understanding it in a better way rather than what it is. When we say what it is, we will find everything similar to high literature. Like it is written, then this also is written. It has human being, this also human being. It is realistic, this also is realistic. It has society, it has psychology, it has all these things. This also has everything. So in both, most of those traditional definitions of literature, they fulfill everything. You can tick mark that this, all things are there. And yet why it is not considered as great literature? So we say what it is not. What it is not. And that helps here. So it said that it does not deal with abstract problems. Something that is not dealing with abstract problems becomes, or it does not raise or answer abstract questions, then it becomes popular literature or pulp fiction. So you can say that the three plays that we were discussing in our last semester, Oedipus, Hamlet, Waiting for Godot, why they are classic? Because they are raising abstract questions. And abstract questions means there are no answers. There are no answers. So at some age, when we are like young adult, we think in absolute things, that either it is yes or no. Jawab na ho yevu kai hoyo j nahi. Badano jawab hoyo j. And apre ek jawab gokhi pan rakho ek, no jawab. But as we grow in life, we realize that, well, there are so many things where there are no answers. That having no answer is, or having abstraction is a sign of maturity. Is a sign of maturity. Not having that is a sign of young adulthood. There is still green or unripe. Green, then we have like absolute answers, and I know everything, and this is this, and that is that. That is what you will find in Sense of an Ending also. They will say that in those school days, we believe in absolutes. Yes or no. When you grow old, you find, well, we were stupid. That we used to think that should be either this or that. But then in life, there are no either or kind of thing. There are not many things in between. That's why this abstractions of life, where if you say all answers are there, well, you are immature. You say, I pick up this holy book, all answers are given. It reflects only your immaturity, not the immaturity. Book never tells that I am complete. It is the reader who says that I read this book and there is completeness. Now I don't have to read any other thing. That is reader's immaturity. The book raises the questions which are full of abstractions. And that's why those books survive quite a long time. It can be holy books also. But the reader who follows those holy books might think that, well, I got all the answers of the life. Then that is immaturity. So something that deals with abstract problems and raises or tries to answer abstract questions, just tries to, but you cannot find those answers there. It is devoid of an explicit ideational element. So something we can call it intellectual formation of idea or concept. So any kind of idea or thing explicitly, it doesn't have, it doesn't tell everything very clearly, but it implies everything. Everything is implied. It is not explicitly told. So we'll see here also whether one is implicit, another is explicit. Explicit means clearly you tell this is this, that is that. You tell everything about all the characters and other things. Whereas this literature will keep everything open-ended. So even in the villain, there is a chance of reading a hero. And even in hero, there is a chance of reading a villain. And so you can do various interpretations from various angles, and you may find that the villain also has heroic qualities. And hero also has kind of a villain, kind of a characteristics, or he can also be an antagonist. And so when retelling happens, you can make the hero a villain, which you have seen in Caliban, Prospero, or even in Hamlet also, like Claudius also is given scenes where we find the genuineness of human being. The prayer scene, for example, where he very clearly states that I know my prayer will not reach to heaven because I am still enjoying the fruits of my bad karma. And he tries to say that, but what can I do? I had an ambition to become a king and I loved Gertrude. So he becomes a kind of a hero, like Heer Ranza, Romeo, Juliet kind of a hero is hidden in Claudius, that he is doing for the love. So you can make Claudius a hero and you can also tell a story. Those possibilities are very important in great literature, whereas the other literature will portray like Bakshi is all bad. You don't see the other aspect of Bakshi, that what are her motivations, that why he also is playing a puppet in the hand of larger corporations or the structures of larger corporations there. So intellectual formation of idea, and that also is very important, that any answer that people try to give is also quite intellectual. The ideas, concepts are a little bit intellectual, and it leads to further thinking. It leads to further. So at the end of reading the text, we have something to think also. While reading, we were feeling something. But at the end of that, we have some food for thoughts also, because some such concepts are given which are new concepts, and so at the end of the day, after reading that, our mental horizons widen a little bit. There is some kind of widening of our intellectual capacities of mind. True, genuine literature will do that. This literature will keep us there only, that what I believed was right. That only there we will remain. It will support our emotional belief system, the popular literature. Symbols are easy to comprehend in this literature, easy to comprehend, whereas here it has layers and a little bit difficult also. It does not demand a scholarly response from readers, scholarly response. When we study cultural studies, and we try to say that there should be no demarcation between highbrow literature and popular literature, or high and low, the lines should be blurred. So in that, what we try to do is that we try to read popular literature with scholarship. So we try to apply scholarly ideas into popular things and try to see what we can get. And that is what we are doing in One Night at the Call Center also. How can we see cyberpunk, globalization, self-help thing, or other things also, how it can be seen. We try to extract those things, though it is very difficult to extract. But in that process, we understand what this text is lacking, what this film is lacking. That also we can understand when we apply. So it doesn't mean that you do not do the scholarly reading of popular literature. You do it. And obviously in doing that, you will find lots of problems in that process also. It lacks high seriousness and sincerity, which Matthew Arnold told in the study of poetry, that these are the benchmarks of good literature. And for him, even poets like Chaucer or Dryden or Pope are not good poets. Chaucer also says he is lacking high seriousness. So under the high marking of what is literature, he finds Shakespeare great beyond all kinds of questioning. He says you read sonnets and or even the plays where the poetry is found in many of the soliloquies. There you find he is up to them. Wherever opportunity or occasion is given, he will stand at the top as if perhaps nobody else can write the lines the way he has written. So even when the Hamlet is in dilemma and somebody says that, well, don't go for a sword fight. It seems that it will be bad, some kind of ill omen somebody reads. So he will say that, well, if it has to be, it has to be. Even in the fall of a sparrow, there is providence. So he can reach at that level and give a poetic expression to that kind of thing. Or even in Macbeth, when he is about to die and the message comes, the Lady Macbeth has committed suicide. The forest is moving. The enemy is attacking. And then those words, tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow. The life is a tale told by an idiot, signifying nothing. So he will reach at that height and will express at that moment something that is so valuable. That is what high seriousness and other thing matters in those things. So that he says, Arnold told that Pope, Alexander Pope and Dryden, he said that they are great prose masters, but I deny them to consider as poet at all. Even they might have written a lot many things in heroic couplet. But he very clearly said that they are our prose masters. They were writing prose in poetic way, but that is not poetry. He denies them to be considered as poet at all. So that way, the very high benchmarks are set and many great poets are nullified, that these are not poets also. In literature, genuine literature, which we call, language is used carefully and reflects high seriousness and sincerity. So the use of language. Now this becomes very important because the idea of simplicity in language is confusing. So sometimes people say that, well, Chetan Bhagat writes so simple, you don't require dictionary. Now, does it mean that he is simple, so he is bad? We'll say, no, it is not that. We have read Old Man and the Sea. It was also a very simple novel. Without dictionary, you can read. And it's just simple 70-80 pages. And you can go through it overnight. You can complete the reading. And you don't require any kind of like hardship or any deep symbols. You don't feel that there are anything that is very complex. I don't know Greek myth, but it was not required to study that. So very simple, even absurd play, all this one, Waiting for Godot. If you read, it is very simple language. You don't require a dictionary to understand. But if you say it, you don't understand it. If you have a dictionary, you don't understand it. If you have a dictionary, you don't understand it. So, but it is very simple. So people use, Wordsworth was using very simple language. Frost is very simple. So it doesn't mean that simplicity means popular. And in that sense, it is not a good literature. But that simplicity also has, because it is carefully used language, and it is like people use a metaphor of crystal clear water. Crystal clear, if there is a rivulet and the water is crystal clear, you can see the bottom of the rivulet or the river or anything, the bottom. It means you can clearly see the thing. That is the clarity of language. That is, that clarity is there. But it doesn't mean it is too simple. But the same clarity has philosophical depth also. It is full of philosophical depth also. That is where Frost, Wordsworth becomes a great poet, even with all kind of simplicities there. Well thought out, deeper and philosophical. That is what you find in that simplicity also. The same way we see here, the difference if we try to see here, we find that this is more concerned, high literature is more concerned about how story is to be told. Whereas this is more concerned about what is to be told. What is the story? So here, story element and content is more important. Whereas here, people think about how to tell this. And their more concentration and creativity is in how, not what to tell. That's why we say that Shakespeare has never told a new story. Not a single new story. He told either took from histories. All the stories from histories he has taken. He wrote historical plays also and tragedies also. Or comedies also were already known stories. Even the comedies were known. It was all translated and available in this Sastu Sahitya. So he wrote a small, he read a small story and wrote a play out of it. So he was not an inventor of plot, but he knew how to tell a story, how to write in between the dialogues and other kinds of things. That is it. Girish Karnad also, many times people, when they ask him that you are only telling about Indian myths, retelling Indian myths in Hayavadan and many other plays. So he said that in that I am like William Shakespeare. Shakespeare also never told new story. He whatever he was given to him, he just told that. So inventing new story is not the parameter of great literature. It is how you do that, and how and what you want to do. If they are very near, then it becomes great work of art. So if the modernists want to say that everything is broken, the world order is broken, there is meaninglessness, there is nothing now in the world left, if that is the vision, then your poetry should be broken. The style of writing should be broken, not only the theme. If your novel should also be broken, and your play also should be broken in structure also, along with what you want to say. So if it is structurally okay, and inside the idea is nothingness, it doesn't work. It doesn't work well. So that is one of the major concerns we will see in this also, that Life of Pi has a beautiful structure. Chetan Bhagat almost copies that structure, or it is very similar to that structure. Then also, why one becomes great, the another law. So that then we have to see something deeper to understand that. Implicit, explicit, we have seen. This is for slow reading, because it is to be chewed and digested. Great work of art is to be chewed. In that, there is no rush to see what is at the end of the story. There is nothing at the end of the story. The real thing is in the journey. Whereas this is page turner, unput downable, very fast reading. So what people do, they are traveling in train or aeroplane, and they have 3-4 hours, and they will pick up one from the store. And within 5 hours, they will read it and then put in another station, put it in the dustbin, and they will move on. These books are for this purpose. So they are sold in large numbers on railway stations, on airports, on bus stations. They are sold in large numbers. Now, as because there are mobile phones now, people don't go to books. But earlier, when the mobile phones were not there, what to do while you are journeying? Well, 5-7 hours in aeroplane, even today, your mobile will not work. No network will be there. So you want something to read. But now people have digital copies, so they don't pick up this. But this was one of the way of looking. So, e prakare rekadi ma vecha to sahit. Station upar, airport upar ne vecha to sahit. Loko pick kare ne. And a bija station ne dustbin ma muki. Or large number of such books are found when a sheep comes for breaking here in Alang. Emma pa ketli badhi aavi chopadi aave. Pachi ek kilo na bhave bar vechava. 150 રૂપિયા માં કિલો આવા સેલ ભાવનગર માં લાગેલા છે. જે પુસ્તક આપણે મોટે ભાગે મહેમાન ને આપીએ આપણે, એ આ પુસ્તક હોય છે. કોઈ વિદ્યાર્થી 2-3 કિલો પુસ્તક ભેટમાં આપી ગયો હોય કે આ 200-300 રૂપિયામાં 2-3 કિલો પુસ્તક આવ્યા છે. એટલે એ જે કિલોના ભાવમાં તમે પુસ્તક લો, ત્યારે તમે કઈ ટાઇટલ લેવું ન દો, જે સરસ પૂઠું હોય એ આપી દો, ચલો સારો ફોટો હોય, કિલોના ભાવમાં તમે પુસ્તક લઈ આવ્યા હો, એન્ડ ધેન યુ ગીવ ટુ ધ પીપલ. એમને આપણે 4-5 પુસ્તકમાં ચોઈસ આપી, આમાંથી લો, બધું સરખું જ હોય, ચોઈસ કરો કે ન કરો, ઈ ડઝન્ટ ડઝન્ટ મેટર. ઈ ક્યાંક બીજાને કોઈને આપે, પછી એને ત્યાં કોઈ આવ્યું હોય તો એને પધરાવે. પેલા વાંચીને પધરાવતા, હવે એમને લોકો આગળ પધરાવતા છે. So this is this the book for it is not like for something chewed and digested, but fast food kind of a thing. This book will become fast food kind of a thing. Chalo pet bharai jato swad mate apre khata hoy to apre emathi nutritious value mare evu bahu ichha apan na hoy ke pani puri khadi che to apre mind power saro thai ena mate badam khavi pade almond apre le to barabar che ke mind power ma kaam kare but pani puri cannot help for a jeep sudhi sar for tongue. There is something for the tongue, something else for the larger good of the body structures. These are character driven, yeah? And these are plot driven, yeah? But even in the plot driven story, yeah, I want to tell a story, every rasprad story kahe ke loko chopdi muki na sar, that is there, because even plot is the soul, as Aristotle used to say. So in that way also they are not plot driven, but they want to tell a story. So they do not care a lot whether things whether there will be deus ex machina or not, yeah? They do not care. they do not try to resolve that deus ex machina in a very significant way. Even in this, as Aristotle used to say, that even if it is there, like you are taking a story from the world where gods and humans used to meet together. એક એવા વિશ્વમાંથી તમે વાર્તા લઈને આવો છો કે ત્યારે તો ખરેખર મનુષ્ય અને ઈશ્વરો વાર્તાલાપ કરતા, ભેગા રહેતા હતા, આવજા કરતા હતા, મિત્રોની જેમ રહેતા હતા. તો ઈશ્વર રહે જ તમારી વાર્તા. યુ કાન્ટ રિમૂવ ધ ગોડ, બટ હાઉ યુ અન્ડરપ્લે ધ ગોડ, ઇવન ઇન દેટ હાઉ યુ મેક ગોડ ઓલ્સો હ્યુમન, એન્ડ વોટ એવર ઇઝ ધ ડિવિનિટી ઇઝ ટુ બી અન્ડરપ્લે. ધેટ્સ વાય સોફોક્લિસ ઇઝ ઇડિપસ બીકમ્સ વેરી ઇમ્પોર્ટન્ટ. Even if the destiny's role is very important, it was said through destiny that this child will do this, it will happen. But then when the play is performed, it is Oedipus who is doing everything. He is telling that you go and ask Oracle, you go and get that servant, you go and bring that soldier who was involved with the child to be thrown in the forest, and everything. He is ordering everybody. In Sophocles' play, Oedipus is man in action. It is not Vidhata who is in action. Their actions are completely absent. That is how they work. Whereas this novel brings in God, sometimes unnecessarily. So that also is the part that can be seen. And characters. This is very important, that powerful characters are drawn. And very real, lifelike, and lot more many things. So second important point for Aristotle also was character. Character was important even that time, and in the modern times in novels, everything is character driven. Charles Dickens' his greatness is about characterization. So even when he makes social criticism, he makes through characters. He prepares characters in such a way that it can work as this. So how powerfully characters are drawn, and what is it to look into the character when they are drawn? We will have a very interesting example between Life of Pi and One Night at the Call Center. Art and craft, or it is art driven, whereas here it is business and market. So Mills and Boon becomes important example. The publisher decides what will sell. The publisher will say that we'll do this, do that, and that market starts controlling the entire narrative here. Then a writer conscious about work of art. So when the writer is writing, even if the writer is great, even if the writer is great, he will not say that, well, I am a great and so I should write something great. They will kill themselves and they will subjugate themselves to the art that is working. So great work of artists, writers will say that once we imagine characters, then characters control us. Then characters are not in our control. That's why Pirandello's play, six characters in search of the author, becomes very significant to study in that. Pirandello's play, six characters in search of I think an author, that is the title of the play. So that becomes here, that art is drawn, and then writer, however great the writer is, will subdue himself to art. અને પછી આર્ટ જેમ એની પાસે કરાવે એવું કામ કરે. જ્યારે અહીંયા લેખકને પહેલેથી એમ હોય કે હું કોઈ ગ્રેટ સાહિત્ય સર્જી રહ્યો છું, એ આભામાં જે લખે. There was this film. મેની ફિલ્મોમાં આવું ઘણી વખત થાય કે લોકોને એમ લાગે કે જાણે એ લોકો મુગલે આઝમ બનાવી રહ્યા છે અથવા બીજું શોલે બનાવી રહ્યા છે. જ્યારે મુગલે આઝમ કે શોલે બનતું ત્યારે એવો ભાવ નહોતો કે આ ગ્રેટ વર્ક ઓફ આર્ટ બની રહી છે, પણ હવે કરે તો એમ થાય કે ના, વી આર મેકિંગ ન્યુ શોલે ઓર મેકિંગ ન્યુ મુગલે આઝમ. ધીસ લાસ્ટ ફિલ્મ વોઝ આલિયા ભટ્ટ વોઝ ધેર, નો નોટ ધીસ, ધેર પાર્ટીશન ઇશ્યુ વોઝ ધેર, કલંક, યસ કલંક ફિલ્મ. સો કલંક ની ફ્રેમ ને બધાની એક્ટિંગ ને એમ લાગે કે આ કઈક મોગલે આઝમ માં બધા કામ કરી રહ્યા છે, એવા ભાવ સાથે એ ડાયલોગ બોલે, એઝ ઇફ સમથિંગ ગ્રેટ ધે આર પરફોર્મિંગ, એન્ડ ધેન ધ ફિલ્મ ઇઝ ગોઈંગ ઇન ટુ ડસ્ટબિન. પીપલ ડુ નોટ ટોક અબાઉટ, ઓર ઇવન ફિલ્મ ભારત ઓલ્સો, એઝ ઇફ યુ આર મેકિંગ અ હિસ્ટોરિકલ નેરેટિવ લાઈક સલમાન રશ્દી, યુ આર એઝ ઇફ કનેક્ટિંગ હિસ્ટરી વિથ કેરેક્ટર ભારત એન્ડ યુ આર ટેલિંગ, બટ નો, ઇટ ઇઝ નોટ ધેટ ગ્રેટ. બટ મેકર્સ થિંક ધેટ દે આર મેકિંગ ગ્રેટ, બટ નો, ઇટ ઇઝ નોટ ગ્રેટ. સો એ ભાવ અહીંયા વધુ હોય કે હું કંઈક ગ્રેટ સર્જી રહ્યો છું, જ્યારે અહીંયા લેખક છે એ કલાને તાબે થઈ જાય કે એ પછી એ સમય નક્કી કરશે. બટ રાઇટ નાઉ આર્ટ ઇઝ મોર ઇમ્પોર્ટન્ટ ફોર મી, એના માટે ગ્રેટનેસ બહુ મહત્વની હોય છે. મેસ્ક્યુલિનિટી એન્ડ ફેમિનિટી, ધીસ ઓલ્સો ઇઝ સ્ટડીડ. સો મેની ઓફ ધીસ ફિક્શન્સ વિચ બીકમ પોપ્યુલર, દે આર લાઈક ફિમેલ રાઇટર્સ રાઇટિંગ, એન્ડ દે રાઇટ ફોર ફિમેલ. And so it becomes that it is more for kitchen politics kind of a thing rather than more abstract issues. It is not about more abstraction of life, but about kitchen and the petty relations of human beings only. About that. And so it becomes a kind of a thing here. So if you remove, but Virginia Woolf is a challenge to this idea. Virginia Woolf is a challenge. You can say that if Jane Austen is writing like this, Jane Austen may be writing like this, but Virginia Woolf is not that kind of a writer. Or as with the passage of time in 20th century, many women writers came who challenged this idea about whether they are only writing about kitchen and love and marriage only, or they are also concerned about higher issues there. Do people give them respect or not? That is another thing. Like we have Arundhati Roy, who also writes about such a great work, but well, it is difficult for even women to give respect to women if they do something great. That is what Jatin Bhagat was talking about, that why women are very hard upon the women. So that is how that femininity and masculinity. So the way, for example, Walt Whitman will write about body in Leaves of Grass and will celebrate the nudity of male body also, or even Old Man and the Sea, not Old Man and the Sea, but Ernest Hemingway, who would write about Farewell to Arms and other novels where there is high masculinity is being there, which sometimes becomes very toxic masculinity also, but still celebrated a lot. And still celebrated a lot. If Old Man and the Sea kind of a novel might be written by a woman, people would not consider for Nobel Prize, for the Nobel Prize that was given for that. So, but it is somebody, man is writing that. And that is how it is considered also there. So that that aspect also it was there to a greater extent now, with the 20th century changing, the things are getting blurred in those this kinds of things. High seriousness and lack of seriousness, we have seen here also, this becomes very important to study here. So I think this all points makes it very clear that what we study in this work, and to study this, some of the important works which you can refer later on are like, these are some of the articles which talk about all these ideas. Peter Swirsky's article, Popular and Popular and Highbrow, is it coming in the focus now? Okay, Highbrow Literature, A Comparative Overview. Yes, Peter Swirsky's article, Popular and Highbrow Literature, A Comparative Overview. Now see, Peter Swirsky is using the word highbrow. So his side is popular literature. He takes the side of popular literature and he makes a case for popular literature in the comparative overview, that why this literature also is good. In today's discussion, we are seeing that One Letter Call Center is not a very great work of art. It is popular and inferior. So from that angle we are discussing. But here he is making a case for popular literature. Another one is Thomas Hacken. H-E-C-K-E-N. Yes, Thomas Hacken. This is Popular Culture. It is popular, full spelling. I have written pop culture. It is popular culture, popular literature, and literary criticism. And literary criticism. Theory as a politics of a term. It is as the theory as the politics of a term. So in and around popular culture, popular literature, and how it tries to look there. And one more interesting work is by Matthew स्नाइडर, SCHINEIDER, मैथ्यू स्नाइडर मेयरसन, मैथ्यू स्नाइडर मेयरसन, पॉपुलर फिक्शन स्टडीज, पॉपुलर फिक्शन स्टडीज, द एडवांटेज, the advantages of a new field. Yes, the advantages of a new field. So that also, so these are some of the significant write-ups which gives comparison between both the things, and it helps us read here. Now, when we want to see this novel in this context, so I hope this context is clear, the very idea about what is popular literature, and obviously in comparison with what we considered literature or highbrow literature. And again, if you want to make a case for popular, you have to use the word highbrow, which is an inferior word. So when you are defining literature, or when you put an adjective before anything, it is a cage. It becomes a cage. It becomes, you are narrowing down the concept, or you are circling around that word. So literature do not want to get circled around. But as soon as you say that, well, Dalit Sahitya, then it is narrowed down. Now it means it is not that Sahitya. It means that Sahitya is a great Sahitya. Dalit Sahitya is inferior Sahitya. Then you say Dalit Sahitya Puraskar. એટલે એ લેખકને પેલામાં પેલી જગ્યાએ ન મળે એવોર્ડ, અહીંયા મળે. સો કે કહો આને સાહિત્ય એવોર્ડ મળ્યો, ત્યાં કોઈ પૂછે કે તો દલિત સાહિત્ય એવોર્ડ મળ્યો. It means it is inferior. So when you put an adjective before this, you are coordinating the word. You are narrowing down the concept. And so highbrow literature, it means now you are talking about literature which is elitist literature, which is considered as the literature. You are narrowing down to that concept also. So we have to be very, very careful in using language also. You have to be very careful in using which word we are using for what, because it may carry some other meanings also. It can imply. Explicit and implicit, all this thing can imply some other things also. So in this context, when we want to see, we want to compare narrative structure of Life of Pi and One Night at the Call Center. So when we want to see this, so in this comparative studies, first, because many of you keep on doing comparative studies time and again in your presentations and other kinds of things. So as we said that, why are we comparing? Why we want to compare? What is this? Before we do, how are we comparing? And we see similarities and dissimilarities. But why? Why are we comparing? So one of the objectives of comparison is that it should give us a new insight into reading the text. It should give us new insight in reading whichever text, either Life of Pi or One Night at the Call Center here. But they help us in reading each other the way we were not able to read without comparing. A compare karya vagar e vastu joi sakati nohoti. એટલે કમ્પેરિઝન કરવાથી હવે એ દેખાય છે, એટલે એકબીજાનો આઈ નો બને છે. દે બીકમ ધ મિરર ઓફ ઈચ અધર, એન્ડ સો દે ટેલ ઓર દે સ્પોટલાઇટ ઓન સમ ડાર્કર આસ્પેક્ટ વિચ વોઝ નોટ વિઝિબલ વિધાઉટ કમ્પેરિંગ. સો ઇફ દેટ ઇઝ ધેર, ધેન કમ્પેરિઝન ઇઝ સિગ્નિફિકન્ટ. વી કેન જસ્ટિફાય દેટ માય પર્પઝ ઓફ કમ્પેરિઝન ઇઝ ધીસ, ટુ ગેટ અ ન્યુ ઇનસાઇટ ઇન ટુ અ પર્ટિક્યુલર ટેક્સ્ટ. Then we also want to see that our why here, another reason also is to see that how one literature is popular and the other is what we call it literature, or what we call it proper literature. Yes. In that context, so into inverted comma literature. So this also, that how this distinction emerges, that also is our purpose to understand the concept of popular literature. For that we are comparing. Now people may say that then why only this? There are so many other texts which are literature. Why don't you compare this with any other text? So you see that, well, this has something very interestingly common. Very interestingly common means it is that aspect that is common which is considered as something good for literature, and that is narrative style. The narrative style, as we see here, that style of writing is very, how the story is told is very important. That makes for greatness of literature. Now in Life of Pi and this, that how is common, narrative style is common, and yet both the literature, one is popular and one is highbrow. That distinct, that is why we narrow down to this text. That is the justification, that why I want to compare this and not other text. So if I can find any other text also to be compared, then I say no, I want to compare with that aspect which is considered as something good for great work of art, that is style of writing, narrative style. And if that is common, and yet if one goes down as popular, then another is lifted up as this. The third question one can say is that why do you consider one great work of art? So people say One Night at the Call Center is popular. You can say many people have said this. So, but Life of Pi, then Life of Pi has got Man Booker Prize. So that is the parameter, that it is given an award by some recognized institute. That's why you consider it as critically acclaimed work of art. It is critically acclaimed work. Well, the One Night at the Call Center is not critically acclaimed work of art. We know that only award doesn't make it that it is great work of art, but still there is, when you compare with another popular, then the reference is very important, that some work is given, whether Nobel Prize or Man Booker Prize, then that can be seen. There can be 10 good books in 2012, and only one is selected, and then you can say that other 9 or 11 were also good, better than this. But it doesn't mean that all books published during 2012 were as equal as this particular book. That we can't say. Shortlisted one, we can debate the politics of awards in shortly. But something that is far away from shortlisting, that you can't use the politics for the defense of that. That sense also is very important when we compare or when we talk about this. So on this ground, we narrow down to the comparative study. So when we sit down to compare, we have to clear the grounds. Lots of ground clearing is necessary. Why this? What is the significance? What do you want to see? Can't you see that without comparing? This question we can ask to self. And then we pick up with proper justification, and then try to see, are we able to see those things or not? Are we able to see those things or not? So when we will compare these things, what we are going to see here, what we are going to find in this reading, is like, first point will be characterization, which is again one of the important parameter for whether good work of art or bad, which we have listed here. So we are using this now here. We are using what we have discussed here in this also. So we have seen that character driven is good. And so we study characterization, and then we try to prove that in one work characterization is very powerful, and in the another one it is lacking that power, or that power we can define as sincerity and seriousness. High seriousness and sincerity is lacking in characterization. So how will we prove that? That we will have to see here. Another very important part is God element. Both the novel has a God element. Both the novel also is centered around the idea of God, right from the beginning to end. So that also is something very important to use it as a comparative tool also. That why I'm comparing, because both the novel deal with God element. And so it becomes very important that how one text is explicit, whereas other is implicit. Yes, how one, so the one, the text which is explicit is popular, implicit is, we consider great work of art. The writer will make use of God element, and they will imply about that. So how that happens, that also we have to observe. So the third point is like a philosophical depth, philosophical depth plus historical breadth and length, or you can say width and height of sincerity. We are deliberately using this semantic field of geometry, geometrical terminology, depth and height and width, and trying to say that the philosophical depth, height of sincerity, high seriousness, that word, and then length and breadth and width of history, how the text is incorporating. That also can be seen in terms of popular will not have all these things, and the other text will have in their construction. And final one, and the final one is about narrator. About the narrator, because as the narrative strategy is common, so we see this and the idea about unreliable narrator. How this idea of unreliable narrator, which is one of the trademark of experiments in literature, experimenting with literature, so it is unreliable narrator is part of experiment, and it is considered postmodern experimentation with literature storytelling. Remember one short story we have seen of Vishal Badani, Vahem. Yes, so you see how the unreliable narrator unfolds. It is experiment that people do, and it is postmodernist, because the one who tells a story is unreliable. We can't believe whether what is told to us is true or not. So that aspect comes here, and in this how in one text it can be seen as reduced to farce, and in another one it questions the meaning of story. It questions in another text the meaning of the story, or it tries to answer, some kinds of long standing debates, how they are answered, or you can say if not answered then interpreted, because answer can be taken as final answer to that, but inference or interpretation, that how some long standing debate, for example, God, existence of God is a very long standing debate. So how this novel Life of Pi tries to interpret that idea through this unreliable narrator, whereas those kinds of thing, or it tries to question the very narrative around the God, how it is doing, and it's not telling us the story about God, it is telling a story about tiger, and then it tells, so it is implied everything, whereas here the very idea of narrator and that is reduced to farce in One Night at the Call Center. It becomes farcical, whereas here it leads to this what we were talking here about abstract questions that it has to lead. So this is the framework in which we want to compare, and we are looking towards to see this. And now what comes is illustrations from the text. One Night at the Call Center is clear. Life of Pi also you might have seen. Some of the scenes we will see and try to see how we can read, so that we can read to reach to this conclusion. So this is the direction in which we are moving when we are comparing the things here. So I think this gives that idea also, comparative study, how one can do comparative study. That idea also as a byproduct you have learned, that what is comparative study, how you can do that. That also becomes significant here. So in this framework, you are doing comparative studies. So now here somewhere when we ask you a question, what tools you have used, what theoretical, what are those differences, what you want to see, actually what you are looking towards, what kind of answers, that now when we ask you, you are clear that okay, you are asking this. Otherwise normally people say ke bhai ahya pan hero chhe na tya pan hero chhe, અહીંયા પણ કુલી છે ને ત્યાં પણ કુલી છે, તો શું કરવાનું? સો વોટ કે એ છે તો શું, બટ વોટ યુ કેન ડુ, વોટ યુ આર લુકિંગ ફોર, વોટ આર યોર ક્વેશ્ચન્સ એન્ડ વોટ પોસિબલ આન્સર્સ, યોર હાઇપોથેટિકલ આન્સર્સ. This we say, these are hypothetical answers towards which we are looking. And now whether we can prove this or not depends upon how we do analysis. આપણે એનાલિસિસ સારું કરીએ તો આપણે હાઇપોથેસિસ સાબિત કરી શકીએ, નહીતર એનાલિસિસમાં એ સાબિત ન થાય તો અવર હાઇપોથેસિસ ઇઝ રોંગ, ધેન ઇટ બીકમ્સ ઓનલી એઝમ્પશન. આ તો તમારી ધારણા જ છે ખાલી કે આવું હોય, આવું ક્યાં સાબિત થાય તમારા એક્સપ્લેનેશન. So that is looking at the film. We will see this. Okay, so we take a break now. Okay? After the break, we will watch the films. It is 1:30. So I think 20 minutes break. After 20 minutes, we will assemble to watch the film. Some part of the film we will see to prove our hypothesis that how it is going on here. And then if you have any questions, we will start with your questions also. Okay, we'll start our things. If you have any doubt or question, or at the end also, we can take the questions.